Let me shortly introduce you. So Effie is with very experienced in agile transformation within different industries, banking, insurance, and telcos in different countries as well. She was at ING more than 18 years, am I right? Doing mostly with years agile transformation, yes, in headquarter and call center.
Yeah.
And she's known for her practical approach and bridging strategic board level with operational execution. And really, Effie's recommendations and Effie's content is always related to the practical topics and practical issues. And I am sure that today's topic, what is agile in reality, will be very interesting for our audience. Effie, I think you can share the screen now.
So lovely. Yeah, thank you for the introduction, Inga, and thank you for having me. It's been my pleasure to help.
Great pleasure for us. Yeah.
It is always great to come to Georgia, visit you, and see the enthusiasm and the great capabilities you're having to change the TBC Bank into an agile organization. So yeah, what you already addressed, I'm gonna talk with you about agile. What is it really? So given, of course, my broader experience from ING and other companies I visited in Russia and Australia and in Europe. So maybe a short intro, because agile is also becoming kind of a buzzword, and normally it's associated with the smaller startups. Of course, it's originated in software development, but these days it is applied to large companies as well. And well, TBC is one of them. You see a lot of agile being done in banking, in insurance, and in telco companies. So in this presentation, I will guide you through three questions. So agile, what is it and what is it not? Where to start if you want to go agile, and why do you need to go all in? And then we're going to touch upon TBC as an example as well, and some lessons learned. So what are the crucial elements of agile, and maybe, well, pitfalls you want to avoid? So actually a bit about the why of agile. Why is it important, or why would you go agile with your company? I think if we look at the world around us, and especially the digital world, we see that it is changing fast. And a couple of facts on this slide are really interesting. So 90% of all data in the world is created in the past 3 years. That's quite a lot. Of course, we use our smartphones a lot. It's become the number one source of traffic. And on this slide, we say we touch upon it 150 times a day, but I think today it's even much more. I'm always a bit embarrassed when I look at my screen time and I get these reports, how much time you spend on your iPhone. And maybe last fact, that this year more people will be on social networks than there were in the planets in the 70s. So the world around us is changing fast, and this drives an increase in customer expectations. So customer expectations are shaped by these digital developments and by other digital innovators. So what customers expect is actually that they have a simple and intuitive customer journey. And I always like to give the example of Uber, where you are in whatever city, and you don't even have to understand where you are. You're out on the street, you open the Uber app, you touch the button, and you order a cab. And the cab is waiting for you. You can see him come your way. You can pay for it. And it is, you don't need an instruction to use. It's very simple and intuitive. Personalized and tailored. So again, maybe look at services like Netflix and Spotify. They personalize their service. You get personalized playlists. You might want to listen to this and this song because you like this and this. A lot of artificial intelligence behind it. But this is also a way of making the services kind of one-on-one. The third thing is that customers expect an instant response. Compared to the old days, where maybe if you need a gift, you would go out to a shop and buy it, and now you go out on the internet, you go to Booking or Bol.com or wherever a company, you order something and it is delivered to your doorstep the next day. And maybe in future, it's even delivered the same day by a drone. Who knows what interesting developments will come on that point. I think the fourth point is that we buy customer journeys and not products anymore. And I think a great example on that is, for example, if I fly to Tbilisi with either Georgian Airways or KLM, is I'm buying an airplane ticket. However, they offer me transportation, they offer me a hotel, and they say, okay, these are the top 10 places you might want to visit when you're in Tbilisi. So it is a journey and not just a product. So this is actually how we see that customer expectations are shaped. And in order to stay relevant as a company, we have to embrace these type of innovations and we have to adapt. We have to adapt to our own activities and we have to adapt our way of working to these expectations. So if you put it very shortly, agile for us means being flexible and able to adapt to change. So agile, what is it and what is it not? What is it not? And I think Vachtang already touched upon that. Agile is never a mean or never a goal in itself. It is an objective. It is always a means to an end. So you want to achieve something with it. And I unfortunately don't speak Georgian, but I think Vachtang in his presentation touched enough upon this topic, is that you want to achieve something with it. It's not something you're going to tick the box with.
Exactly.
Yeah. My Georgian is improving, hopefully, after a little over a year.
You understand something in Georgian.
Of course. It's a very small part. So what is Agile? Also, it is not just Scrum and IT. It's not just IT. It's not beanbags and fancy offices. And of course, we like the fancy offices. And we like the great outlooks. And also at TBC, it's beautiful. But maybe it's also good to touch upon why do we have fancy offices in Agile organizations? Because we want to stimulate interaction. And what we'll discuss a bit later is Agile is a very flat organization. It's non-hierarchical, and it's very much based on interaction between people and between teams. And this is why we change these offices and we change these settings. So we tear down walls. We make big stairs. At ING in headquarters, we had these big stairs. If you look at Zappos, an inspirational company in the US where we flew out to at some point in time, they have a pantry, so where you can get your coffee, on every other floor. Why is that? It's to stimulate interaction between floors or people. In an elevator, you have these touch screens and you can play little games. So this is to stimulate interaction between people in the elevator. So again, Agile is not just beanbags and fancy offices. Of course, it can be part of it.
Yeah, but not all.
Agile is also not just a change in leadership and just trainings. I was in a large company down under and they started an Agile pilot and they focused on these trainings and these new Agile way of working and doing stand-ups and retros and all these things. But they kind of forgot to make and to compose the teams in a proper way. So teams were sometimes lacking resources, lacking IT resources, lacking funding, and they were also lacking kind of a interaction with the rest of the organization. And what happens then is that you get frustrated teams. So Agile is also not just leadership, different behavior and different trainings, but it is more than that.
Yeah.
So. Looking at Agile, what is it really? In the end, Agile is hundreds of great teams supported by a stable backbone. So a team, and I think Vachtang also touched upon that topic, is responsible for a product or a customer journey. And what we always say it is they are end-to-end responsible. So they are responsible for the full customer journey and the full product. So that's why they need to be multifunctional, different type of teams, different type of people in a team. What is important is that they are created around a common goal and a common purpose. So I understood that Vachtang also touched upon the tribes a bit. Normally you form teams in a tribe. A tribe has a common purpose. So for example, the mortgage tribe has the purpose to have the most leading, innovative and customer-friendly mortgage process. And then the eight teams who consist of that tribe, they have their own purposes. So maybe they are responsible for the digital journey or they are responsible for the repayment of a mortgage. So they all have a purpose, but they have a shared purpose as well. I think the second thing is what is really important with an agile organization and the basis of these teams is that they measure success. Because in the end, yes, they have a common goal, they have their own goal, but they have to measure what is success. And what is good to understand is that this is a different way. And let me give an example of the call center. So the call center at ING is one of the parts from ING that I transformed together with lots of other people to an agile organization. Before we went agile, actually, we had kind of KPIs, a way of measuring the average handle time, touch times. We had scripting in the call centers, so people had to read a script when a customer was asking a certain question. After agile, how do you measure success? You measure success if the customer is happy after the contact with the call center. So is the NPS at a proper level? Could we help the customer directly? So what we call first time fix without a handover. So if somebody is reaching out to us as a company, are we able to help him directly? So his problem is fixed and he don't have to call us again, or we don't have to recall him. So really important with these teams, clear purpose, very clear way of measuring. And again, it is a kind of a very different way than we had before. Then maybe switching to the part where we say, okay, if you want to go agile, where do you start or how does it actually look like? So on this slide, you see we divided a company and whatever, if it's banking, insurance, telco, whatever type of company you have, in kind of four blocks. So the delivery part of the company, that's what we call business and IT. So this is where the change happens. So where you have people who are responsible for products and processes, and we have to adapt to client needs, or we have new legislation or whatever. So that part of the company. And that's where we normally start, actually. And that's what you also have seen at TBC. You form tribes around these end-to-end customer journeys, multifunctional teams. Other parts of the company, the service part. So normally that is the call center and operations or back office, where you like to call it, sales and the support functions. What is really interesting, I think, is that we start agile mostly within the delivery organization because we have the goal to have a perfect customer journey, to increase time to market, to make happy customers. And this is where we kind of design these products and, these processes. But we can apply the agile principles to the other parts of the company as well. So if you look at the kind of three most important agile principles, looking at these teams, that is that teams are end-to-end responsible, they are multifunctional, so everybody is in the team that the team needs, and the team is self-steering. And these three elements you will see in all these operating models of agile. So in customer service, again, for example, ING, when we did the change into the call and operations, we joined it together. We made self-managing teams end-to-end responsible for their performance. Most important was that there were no handovers allowed, so they could help customers directly. On the support part, what you see is, for example, risk and legal, and especially in a bank, they are really important because if we change a process, we tend to have an agreement from risk and legal as well. In an agile model, what we do is we have flow to work pools. So in the old days, you would go from a team and call a risk or a legal officer and say, hey, this is the change I want to make in this process. Is that okay with you? And then we have to wait a bit and get an answer. In an agile organization, you say, please come and join the team part-time, so maybe half a day a week, and we interact. And they understand what the team is doing, where they're going, they can give their ideas, and then gradually, together, we form the new process. So that is also kind of a completely different way of working as opposite to the other organization and the more traditional organizations. So kind of summarizing it, most companies start in the delivery and then grow to other parts of the company. Because they see it is working and it helps. But in the end, it's the same agile principles. Maybe one of the most important slides, I think, in this story is that you can only succeed if you go all in. And what does going all in means? It means that you have to touch upon all these topics in this wheel. So in the middle, you find the strategy. Now, again, we touch upon that many times. What do you want to achieve with Agile? Make sure you have a very clear view on that. Because again, it is never a goal in itself. It is always a means. Then looking at the other parts, structure. It is a completely different structure. Huh? Agile is a very flat organization with completely different roles and responsibilities. So we have product owners, we have tribe leads, we have Agile coaches. Those are new roles and different roles as opposite in the old organization. Reporting structure is different, huh? So it is not the hierarchical lines. It is a completely different way of working together. And maybe also directly then touching upon the leadership part. Leadership kind of change into a servant leader, being a servant leader instead of making decisions full time and making sure that you have all the information from the bottom of the organization flowing up to you as a leader. In an Agile organization, what you do as a leader is you support your teams and you're there to help them. And you go and get this information. So you don't say, can you please send me this Excel sheet of this PowerPoint and report back to me on the progress of project number 3, 4, and 5. No, you go down on the floor, on the shop floor, you join the teams in the stand-ups and the retros, and you see what's going on. Yeah, maybe Vartan can comment on it or Inga, but it's, yeah, quite it's a new way of working. So this is where we see this big shift in leadership. And for many leaders, and I think that is, we will touch upon that later, but a point that TBC did very well, it is a bit scary because it feels like letting go. And I was a manager and I was always kind of holding on quite tight in my organization, especially a call center where you have to reach all these goals and answer all these calls. But Agile is actually very much data driven. And people tend to forget that. It is not like you're steering in the dark, but there is an enormous amount of data because you can go down on the floor. You can look into Jira. Jira is some nice name of how we kind of write down and keep track of what the teams are doing. So I can look into Jira. I can join planning sessions. I can join stand-ups and retros. We have Obeya walls. Well, these are very nice rooms where we actually say, this is how, as a company, we prioritized all of our capacity and we see progress. And that, to be honest, to me, that was much nicer and much better than all this endless long meetings where we had to discuss endless PowerPoints with endless amount of people. So I think it is a big shift, but yeah, leadership very important. Talent management, different way of hiring, different way of onboarding. What do you teach your people? How you work with them? The processes, of course, what I already touched upon, retro, stand-up, planning sessions. I think I understood a bit of Vartan's presentation that you already touched upon the QBR. So a different way of prioritization. I remember when I joined TBC that I already told them a year ago that the QBR is a great way of prioritizing your strategic goals and together looking one quarter ahead and one quarter back. But it is a bit difficult to get used to it, to be trained by it. And now we're definitely getting it. Huh? But it takes some time. Because yeah, it is a different
way. Next time, Effie, on the conference, you have to make in Georgian. You understand?
Yeah, actually, I think I'm at the point now that I have to start learning Georgian because otherwise, then I can finally really join you. But yeah, QBR is also a new process, a different way of prioritizing the scarce resources you have. The left down part, the tech part, of course, IT, you can't do releases every 3 months. If one of your goals is fast time to market and you have sprints, so small goals which you want to achieve every 2 or 3 weeks, you have to have a frequently release cycle. So the testing, the deployment has to be done at a high pace. And other speakers in this day will touch upon that. But it is important and it facilitates your whole Agile movement. Yeah, the power of TBC. And this, to me, this is, to be honest, one of the great slides to discuss, because I had the honor of helping TBC for over a year now. I joined March last year, so I've been helping for kind of 15 months. And of course, it is not a walk in the park. And as I told Inga and the board at some time as well, in the beginning, it's all fun and great and a lot of energy, but at some time you have to fine tune it. And then you start learning and learning again and again and again. And I think that is the some of the things that, that TBC did really, really well. So maybe give a more structured information on that. I think you had a very solid start. The preparation going agile was really good, but you also stopped at some point in time. And also related to the previous presentation, you dared to jump in, because I also visited some clients in Eastern Europe, and they prepared going agile for kind of 9 months and then created 10 centimeters of PowerPoint. And to be honest, that's not the way to go, because at some point, yes, you have to really have a clear view on what do you want to achieve, design your organization, and then start doing it. The aligned and committed leadership team, this is really of crucial essence, and I can't emphasize that enough, because this is the thing I see going wrong most of the time in other companies, also worldwide, is that they think it's something HR needs to do because it's also behavior, or it's just IT. It is not. Agile is a completely new way of working, and it is your new business model. So your whole team has to be committed. And I saw some pictures. I think this is really the one of the forces of TBC, that the whole team is committed and is aligned on what they want to achieve, and the excitement. You need the fun, the energy, and the excitement to go for it, because after a couple of months, the honeymoon period is over, and then you discover it is a lot of work. It is, you'll get a lot of rewards, and yes, you will reach your goals, but you have to put in a lot of energy, and it's not something you can touch upon in kind of 3 months and tick the box and it's done. The learning and improving, evaluate periodically and ad hoc. We have these kind of scans for the tribes. How are they doing? How are the people doing? How is the teams? How are the teams doing? We have these agile maturity models. How can we help them the best? Able to adjust, I think that is also something that was done really well, because actually we changed the structure already quite a few times at the TBC. And this is what Agile is. Definitely. It is, new things, new ways, and then adjust, because some things aren't working. Okay, let's evaluate and try something new. It is really important. And the leadership team, again, they role model behavior. Huh? If you want to innovate, you must make mistakes and you must learn to be open and transparent about it. And that is something that really I was really impressed by, is that the leadership team, they showed in certain sessions that sometimes they also don't make the perfect decision, but they learn from it. And it's okay to discuss it. And this is what you want in an organization. You want to be transparent, you want people to feel safe, and you want it to be okay to try something, and if it doesn't work, try again. And sometimes it wasn't really, maybe not the best decision. Well, so be it, and let's move on again. And I think this is one of the things that that was done in a really great way. The third thing, aligning agile to the non-agile parts of the organization. Yeah, as I briefly touched upon that before, it is really difficult, because if you are going agile in headquarters, so in the change part of the organization, the rest of the organization is still in kind of traditional mode. So they still have the hierarchy, they still have the KPIs, they still have the old budgeting process, and how does it work together? And you really need to be sensitive to that, because otherwise, both the agile teams, but also the part of the organization which is not agile, will become frustrated. Because, they are steered and they are working in a different way. So I think that is something that TBC has done really well from the start. For example, with risk and legal. So how do we work together in a correct way? And in the end, expanding it. Because what was really nice for me to see is that also support functions said, hey, this is a great way of working. We can achieve a lot. This would also work for us. And that's actually what we're doing now, expanding this whole agile way of working to those parts of the company as well. So I think that looking at TBC, this is what you did really well and really a great job and really important. Because it is a full package and you cannot cherry pick going in agile. I think being sensitive to time, I'll just quickly touch upon this because I saw another slide also in Wachtang's presentation, which has the TBC example. But it is a fundamental transformation across your organization. This is a different organization, but here you see how much effort it is to go agile in coaching capability, in design, in QBR sessions, in structure, in all these changes you have to make. Maybe worldwide, what is really interesting is that agile is on top of the minds of worldwide organizations, 70% consider it top three priority. But what is really interesting is that actually less than 4% of all companies were able to go all in. So going all in meaning that they transformed to full agile organization. So I think this emphasizes the importance of agile. This emphasizes the power of agile and what you can achieve with it. However, that it is not a walk in the park and that is it is a journey and you need to embark upon it. And then, going actually to the final slide, the lessons learned. Well, we touch upon most of them. The commitment and the top level of your organization is crucial. Look beyond your industry for inspiration. And that is, it is fun as well. What we did at ING is we looked at Zappos, the shoe retailer. We looked at Spotify. We looked at a lot of companies being non-banking because they have great innovations and great ideas and you can apply them. Well, the making the mistakes part, selecting the right people. Not everybody fits an agile organization, especially, for example, when the change we did at the call center in ING. Some people just don't want to work in an organization where they have a lot of empowerment and a lot of responsibility and work in self-managing teams. That's okay. But be bold enough to admit it. I'm always still, I think that you do have to select when you go agile because again, not everybody fits in this type of organization. Empowering your people and empowering is more than just a buzzword because I can say to somebody, hey, you're empowered now to make a decision. Then I always paraphrase this nice quote I saw on the internet that I'm empowered to renovate my kitchen, but if I don't have the capabilities, the tools, or the funding to do so, I still can't renovate my kitchen. So empowering people means helping them with procedures, with whatever, funding, with capability, with training, with skill sets, because otherwise it's just something, which looks good and sounds great, but it's not really happening. And the people and the teams is what it's all about in Agile. Yeah, get started and learn. And Agile is fun. I think it can create and it will create a lot of energy. Again, it takes time to change, but along the way you will see the results and you will transform your organization and gradually move into this world where you can adapt to changes and you can answer to these changing client needs. And that's what I see TBC doing as well. So I think this is basically what I wanted to share with you.
Thank you, Effie.